In this video, we're going to implement an infinite pagination component with React Query. This is something that you would typically see in a social media application where you have your main feed and you can virtually doom scroll forever, as I'm sure many of us do. So here's what we're going to be building. We have a paginated list here of items with 10 items per page. And as we scroll down to the bottom, once we reach the last item, automatically the next batch of items is going to be loaded. Then we have our next page of items, and if we scroll down to the bottom once again, once we reach the last item, another fetch is fired. And this will go on until all of the items are fetched, which currently there's about 100 of them. To do this, we'll be using the Tanstack Query package, otherwise known as React Query, for all of our fetching. We're also going to be using the React Intersection Observer library to basically create an element that we can track and see when it becomes visible on the screen, and then use that to trigger the fetch for the next page of items. Also, to make it easier for you, you'll be able to find all of this code on GitHub. I've created a repository for it. You can clone that and easily install all of the dependencies. The link for that will be in the description right below that subscribe button. So let's begin. First, we're going to start by implementing infinite pagination through React Query. Now, luckily, React Query actually has great native support for this, which will make our life a lot easier. The first thing that we need to do is that we need to set up React Query in our project. And for this, we're going to have to create a query client and wrap our entire app with a query client provider. I'm not going to go too deep into this because I have a whole tutorial video on React Query that you can go and watch to get yourself up to speed. So first, here at the top, let's create a new import and let's access query client and query client provider from React Query. And then we're going to take the query client and we'll come here on a new line and we're going to create a query client. So we're going to do const query client equals new query client and then call it. Then we're going to take the query client provider and come down here where we're actually rendering our app, and we're going to wrap our app component with the query client provider. And then we're also going to have to pass it the query client under its client prop. And with this, React Query is now fully set up in our application, and we have everything that we need to start using it in our components. Next, we're going to go here to the app component and start implementing our infinite pagination. Now, the great thing about React Query is that it actually offers us a hook, use infinite query, which natively supports infinite pagination. With it, we'll be able to access everything that we need. So we're going to come here at the top and we're going to import use infinite query from React Query. And then in the body of the component, we can directly start using it. So we can write use infinite query like so and then call it. Now, as you can see here, we have an error. And that's because use infinite query actually expects some arguments. For this video, we're only going to pass it one argument, which is going to be the object that we use to configure how this hook is going to work. Now, this object has a couple of required properties that we have to give to it. And the first property is going to be the query key. If you've ever used React Query, you'll know that it uses the query key to do all of its caching and basically do all of its cool functionalities. So that's why it's required. And since we're going to be fetching items in this application, as we've seen at the start of this video, we're going to give items as the query key. The next thing that we have to provide is the actual query function that this hook will use to fetch its data. And this is going to be under the query fn parameter. Now for this, we're actually going to use a function that I created already. And that function, if you go here to the sidebar, is under the API folder in this items.ts file. If I open this file, it contains some code that we can use. This file exports here at the bottom a fetch items function, which basically simulates a fetch by returning pages of the static items array here at the top. And since React Query expects any asynchronous function, this will work perfectly fine even if it's not an actual fetch request. This function takes only one argument, and that is going to be an object with a pageParam property. Now this is important because this pageParam right here comes automatically from React Query and will hold the latest page to fetch. And actually, you cannot change the way that this is named, as you're going to see in just a moment. The function will take the pageParam and then return based off of that a subset of the items here at the top in an object containing data, current page, and next page as properties. Now these values here in this object, what you return from this function, you can control and you can name however you want, but keep in mind that you're going to need to use them later on to actually tell React Query how to manage the different pages and update its state. We're going to see this again in just just a moment. Now, going back to the app component, we can import this fetch items function and pass it as the query function to use infinite query. Here, as you can see, the way we're passing it lets React Query call it directly with the page parent property and the object that we just talked about. The next required parameter that we need is the initial page param. This parameter is going to determine the first page that we want to fetch whenever this component is mounted and this query is ran for the first time. In our case, this is going to be 0, right? Because we're going to want to be fetching the first page. And finally, we also need to provide a function to tell React Query how to get the next page parameter. Now, this is important because React Query is going to use this parameter to first call the query function with the next page param, and then also use it to determine if there even is a next page to fetch in the first place. So we're going to write get next page param, and this will be a function that takes in three arguments. The first argument is last page, then all pages, and finally last page param. Last page will contain the response from the last page that was fetched. This will contain all of the data returned from the promise of that page. This will not be the page param that the function was called with, but rather the entire data object. All pages is almost the same, but it will contain all of the data from all previously fetched pages. And finally, last page param is the page parameter that the query function here was last called with. Now, this is important because you're going to be using some of these arguments to determine the next page parameter. And this will completely depend on where you're actually fetching your data from. If you're fetching your data from a backend that uses cursor-based pagination, you're going to have to use the cursor to determine the next page parameter. If instead you're using something that is offset-based pagination, you'll have to use the offset to determine the next page. That's why I said that, going back to the fetch items function, that the return object here is completely customizable and in your control. You're going to need to use this to determine the next page parameter. Now, in our case, we actually get a next page parameter returned right here. And this one is automatically handled for us, which is great. We don't have to do it. This is basically simulating a backend that would automatically handle this for you. So what this means for us is that we can actually get rid of the last two arguments of this function and just use the last page argument. This is going to contain our next page property, which we can use. So we can remove both arguments and return from this function lastPage.nextPage like so. Now this will get used by React Query and this hook to determine the next page parameter to fetch with. And also note that the next page argument here can be null. In that case, it will mean that we've reached the end and that there is no more data to fetch. And React Query will also use this internally to know whether or not there is more data and will give us access to some properties to update our UI if that is the case. And with this, we gave use infinite query everything that it needs. Now, there are more options that you can provide. And for that, I will encourage you to check out the React Query docs. The information there is stellar. But for now, for this video, this is enough. We can then start accessing some of this value that this hook returns and start building our UI. First, we'll create a const and destructure the return value of this hook. We'll start by accessing data, which will hold our fetch data. Then we'll also use status, which will hold the status of the query. The status will basically allow us to determine if we're fetching something, if there's an error, or if we can show the data. And to be able to show an error, we'll also need to access the error value. Then, in the return function of this component, we can start rendering some UI. We'll first render something if we are currently fetching any data. And for that, we can use the status and check for pending. If we're fetching data, we can show a simple div that just says loading. Then we'll check if the status is error, and if it is, we'll render another simple div with the error message, which we can access from the error object that we got from use infinite query. Otherwise, if we're not currently fetching any data, and if we also don't have an error, we can proceed to rendering all of our pages. Now, this data property here that is returned from use infinite query will actually hold an array of pages. So we will have to map over each page. And then for each page, we're going to have to map over all of the items within that page. So that's going to be a loop within a loop. So first, let's start from the top and map over each page. We can do div, and then inside of the div, we can do data.pages.map, and then access the page property here. And then for each page, we'll return a simple div with page.currentPage as a key. And that div for now is going to be empty. This page.currentPage property, remember, comes directly from our fetch items function, which returns an object that also has the current page. Then let's add some basic styles to the wrapper div so that we have some spacing between each page. We can add a class name property, and then inside of it, we can give it flex, flex call, and then a gap of 2. Then we're going to have to render all of the items on a specific page. So inside of this inner div here, we can map over the data of that page. So we can do page.data.map and then access the item. And then for every item, we can return a simple div with item.id as a key and then item.name inside. We'll also give this inner wrapper div here the same styles to also have some flex and some spacing. So we'll do a class name, and then inside we'll add flex, flex call, and then gap of 2. And finally, let's also give some basic styles to each item. We can add some padding, we can add a background color, and make it just a little bit rounded. Now, if we go back and look at our application, we have a list of items displayed. We have a total of 10 items representing the first page of our data. This is great. This works exactly as we expected. Now, the only thing that we have to do is to start fetching the next page once we scroll to the end of the list. For this, we'll use the React Intersection Observer library, which makes it really easy to access the browser's native intersection API and determine if an element is in view or not. What we're going to do is we're going to create a simple div at the end of all of the pages, and then we'll use the intersection API to determine when that div is in view. And when it is, we'll just trigger a new fetch of the next page from React Query. So first, we're going to need to import the useInView hook from React Intersection Observer. This hook will make it really easy for us to implement our intersection div. Then, right below the useInfiniteQuery hook, we can write const and then ref, comma, inView equals inView. We'll have to take this ref here and pass it to our intersection div, and then when it becomes visible on the screen, this inView boolean is going to be set to true. Then we can come here to our JSX in the return function, and below all of our pages, we can create an empty div. And to that empty div, we can give it the ref that we have above. Now, every time that this div will come in view, the in view value that we have above will be set to true automatically. We don't have to do anything else. And then we'll be able to use this to trigger a fetch of the next page. Now, the fetching of the next page of items is going to be super simple. UseInfiniteQuery provides us with a handy function that we can call to fetch the next page. It's conveniently called fetchNextPage. So we can come here to UseInfiniteQuery and access it right here. This function will use the getNextPageParameter function that we provided here to determine the next page to fetch. And then it's going to pass the correct page parameter to this fetchItems function, fetching the correct set of items. We don't have to manage this ourselves. We can then create a useEffect that will listen to inView, and then when that changes and becomes true, we can call fetchNextPage. So we'll come here and we'll create a useEffect, and then inside of the body, we're going to do if inView, then we're going to fetch the next page. Of course, we'll need to import useEffect from React, as well as provide fetchNextPage and inView to the dependency array, because they are used inside of the effect. And now, with this, if we go back to our app and refresh so that we have a clean slate, whenever we scroll to the bottom of the page, the next page of items is automatically going to be fetched, and we can see it right here. If you scroll to the bottom again, the next page after that is also going to be fetched. This will go on until we have run out of items. And just like that, we have infinite pagination in our application. Now, there's one little improvement that we can make to this. Currently, we're not showing anything to the user when a new page is being fetched. It will be helpful and a better user experience to show some UI whenever we're fetching another page so that our users can see that something is going on. And the simplest way to do that is to go back to our VS Code, and then inside of our intersection div, just add some text that says loading if we are currently fetching some data. And to know whether or not we are currently fetching something, we can come back here to the top of our component to useInfiniteQuery, and we can access the isFetchingNextPage property. This is going to be a boolean that will be true if we're currently fetching a next page. And then we can go back down to our intersection div, and then inside of it, we can write if isFetchingNextPage, then we're going to show this loading text, otherwise we're not going to show anything. The div can remain empty if we're not currently fetching anything. And now with this, if we go one more time to our app, refresh once again to have a clean slate, every time we scroll to the bottom, we get this nice loading UI that shows us that something is indeed loading. Our user experience is now good, and we've successfully implemented infinite pagination in our React application. Now, as I've said before, you can go way deeper than this. You can access more properties from Use Infinite Query, and you can also configure it in more ways that I've shown in this video. If you want to play around with this, which honestly I recommend, remember that this is available on GitHub as a repository right below that subscribe button. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see more videos just like these, make sure to leave a big thumbs up to this video. You can also click here to subscribe, or you can click here to watch a different video of mine that YouTube seems to think that you're really going to enjoy. And with that being said, my name has been Darius Kozin. This is Kozin Solutions. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Ciao, ciao.